So, ladies and gentlemen, I give you His Excellency Judge Weeramantry.
Well, thank you very much, Professor French, for that kind introduction. And let me commence by saying how pleased I am to be able to address an audience in this historic city, and especially in the year which is the 800th anniversary of Magna Carta. The whole world should have been talking about the city of Lincoln. And I'm so pleased to be here at the university and to address this distinguished gathering on a topic which is vital to the human future. Now, it so happens that we are damaging the environment in a manner so critical, so crucial, and I might almost say so wicked, that it has no precedent in human history. We talk a great deal about our affection for our children, but we are damaging our children and our children's children, as no generation has ever done since the human race began. And this is very sad, having regard to the wealth of global wisdom there is on the protection of the environment. Now, this goes back to every customary system of law in the world, to every religious tradition, and to all the wisdom of humanity. But international law has, for some reason, failed to protect us against this terrible usurpation of the rights of future generations. I might just commence by talking about, mentioning what Jesus himself said about those who interfere with the rights of children, or those who place obstacles in the path of children. He said it would be better for them if a millstone were tied around their necks and they were dropped in the ocean. That is the degree of the criminality of interference with the rights of children and future generations. And every religion re-echoes this principle. Every traditional system emphasizes it. And yet we, in our worldly wisdom, ignore it. Now, this is very sad. And sadder still, when a discipline which is so concerned with the human future, or which ought to be so concerned with the human future, as law, is a discipline that should be standing guard against this usurpation of the rights of future generations. Now, let me commence by giving you a couple. This is partly because law has grown so Eurocentric and so egocentric that it looks only at the letter of the law and not at the principles behind the law. There again, Jesus in Matthew chapter 23 is quite explicit in his condemnation of lawyers for only looking at the letter of the law and not the broader principles behind the law. Now, this is partly because law and especially international law and religion have drifted far apart from each other. And that occurred because of the wars of religion in the 17th century particularly. I will refer to that later. But let me now give you a couple of my personal experiences. In 1976, it so happened, of course, that was the bicentennial of American independence. And America was justly proud of its constitution and the emphasis it placed on equality and freedom. And it had a World Congress on Equality and Freedom, attended by jurists from all over the world, at which three presentations were provided for. One for the Western world by the president of the Society of Legal Philosophy, one for the communist world by the chairman of law research of Hungary, and it so happened that I was asked to make the presentation for the third world. So this made me study in depth the ways in which third world culture had thought almost far ahead of other cultures of some of these basic principles, and of the ways in which other cultures have ignored this, sidestepped it, pretended that it does not exist. So I did some research into this, And I gave a number of instances in my speech, which took my audience, I think, by surprise. I started with Hindu law, one of the oldest legal systems in the world, and the ways in which Hindu law had gone in great depth into the ruler's duty to protect the environment. In fact, there's a book called the Kautilya, the Arthashastra, written by Kautilya in about the 3rd century BC, where the duties of the king were specified to the extent of even nominating 30 areas where he should appoint superintendents to look after the environment. Rivers, forests, wildlife, all of those, each of them should have a superintendent who was to be responsible to the king for the safety and protection of that item of property. So this was 3,000 years ago nearly. And that was Kautilya's Arthashastra, which is far in advance of many modern Western books on the environment. And it specified these as royal duties to be carried out by the king through superintendents, of whom 30 were named. Then again, there's Buddhism, and there's a story from the history of my own country, Sri Lanka. About the 3rd century BC, the emperor, there was a king called Devanampiyatissa in Sri Lanka, who was, of course, a good king, and it was he who adopted Buddhism. But before he did so, he was out once on a hunting trip. And then one of the disciples of the Buddha appeared suddenly before him and said, "What is this you are doing, O king? Remember, you may be the king of this country, but you are not the owner of this land. Ownership is very different from having the right to enjoy it. You have the right to enjoy it as you can, but do not damage it." And in the Dhammapada, the collection of sayings of the Buddha, there is this beautiful saying that you must enjoy the environment as the bee sucks honey from the flower. The bee takes honey from the flower, but leaves the flower intact, undamaged, and in all its beauty. That's what you have to do in regard to the environment. Take what you need from it for your own sustenance, but preserve and protect it. So Buddhism, there is this principle enshrined. The king was told, you are the king of this country, but not the owner of this land. You hold it for the benefit of those who are to come after you, and for all creatures who are entitled to enjoy it. Now, there is this story again in Judaism that there were two people contesting the ownership of a piece of land. And as you know, they must have had good lawyers. They made a very good case before the judge. And the judge was unable to decide between these two cases. So the judge thought, he just bent down and whispered to the land, "You know, these two people say they own you. Please tell me who really owns you." And the land whispered back, "They don't own me, I own them." So that was the sort of tradition that existed in all of these religions. And of course, Adam and Eve had the Garden of Eden, not to despoil it, but to protect and preserve it. Of course, they were entitled to enjoy it, but not to destroy it or damage it. Now then again, Islamic law is so rich in all these principles. There is a beautiful passage in the Quran saying that the true followers of the Almighty are those who tread lightly on the earth. What a beautiful passage that is. And I use that as the title of the book I wrote on what five religions teach about the environment. You tread lightly on the earth, not leave a heavy footprint which is there for the rest of time and damages the inheritance of posterity. We are all trustees. So that is a principle that is ingrained in religious wisdom and has been for upwards of 2 millennia, even 3 millennia. But we ignore it. And it's a funny thing, you know, the law draws all its inspiration supposedly from religion. but ignores the fundamental teachings of religion. And here are Christian legal systems permitting an absolute denial of a basic principle taught by Christ, that we must look after our children and their interests. And when you think of this world situation, where we have thousands of nuclear bombs in storage in arsenals across the world, each one of which is capable of killing millions of people and damaging the environment for multiples of 25,000 years. That's 1,000 generations. Every time a nuclear bomb is exploded, 1,000 generations are being damaged, because 1,000 generations of children will be growing up and playing in areas contaminated by nuclear weapons, absorbing radiation and damaging their entire future. Now that is what we are doing to our children, and we claim to be civilized. This is really a tremendous travesty of justice and a tremendous denial of the basic principles of international law. Now this is why I have stressed that international law may have good reason, may have had good reason in the 17th century to break away from religion. In the 30 Years' War, which raged from 1618 to 1648, there was a horrendous killing of Christians by Christians in the name of Christianity. And great lawyers like Hugo Grotius of Holland, who wrote his famous book on war and peace in 1625, in the midst of the 30 Years' War, had very good reason to distance the discipline of international law from religion. Against that background, they were quite right in doing so. Against our background, we are quite wrong in doing so. And that is why I have stressed that there is an enormous reservoir of accumulated wisdom available as a global inheritance to all humanity. All religions teach this. We ignore it, and we permit our international law to function in isolation from this enormous reservoir of wisdom. Let us rebuild the bridges, and it is our duty, the duty of our generation, to rebuild those bridges, because time is running out. The nuclear bomb is there, many of them on hair trigger alert. They are set off not by the president of a country, but by a machine. And machines are capable of error. And errors have been nearly committed quite a few times. We must be thankful to Providence for saving us from nuclear accidents and accidental nuclear wars. But we think that for 70 years, we have been free of a nuclear weapon being used. That's absolutely fallacious. Quite often, we were on the very brink of nuclear war. And if another nuclear explosion takes place in warfare, it is not going to be on a lame duck target like Hiroshima or Nagasaki, which cannot retaliate. That target would retaliate because nuclear weapons are available all over. And once the bombs start flying in both directions, there is what is called a nuclear winter that would set in, because the debris would cloud out all the atmosphere, the sunlight, and there would be crop failures throughout the world. We'll be reduced to groveling in the soil to try to find out a root or two to eat. It could be even as bad as that. And that is the danger that the nuclear weapon poses to us. Time is running out. I should think that we have been lucky so far to avoid the use of a nuclear weapon with possible retaliation. We might be lucky to survive another 15 years, but nuclear weapons are increasing. The number of people who are trying to lay their hands on nuclear weapons are also increasing. The raw materials are freely available, because all these nuclear reactors all over the world, they don't have any proper inventories. Nobody knows what happens to the nuclear waste, which is the raw material for making the nuclear bomb. The knowledge is available, the money is available to produce these bombs, and very interestingly, the knowledge is available. Let me tell you something from my personal experience. I was once asked by the London Bar, members of the London Bar, to give a talk on some of these topics. And one of the things I said was that the knowledge of how to make a crude nuclear weapon is now available to any good student of physics on internet. I said this, of course, I'm not a physicist, but I said this, but after my lecture, you know, various people come and talk to you, and there was a professor of physics from a London university. When he spoke to me, I asked him, did I overpaint the picture when I said this? He said, not at all. If I have a PhD student in physics who cannot do that, I would think him unworthy of a PhD. So there you are, the knowledge is available. The raw material is available. The financiers are available. The people are waiting. The bomb is waiting to fall into some irresponsible hands. And you can't have policemen going around telling people not to do something which the policeman is doing. Now the nuclear powers are telling all the rest of the world, don't do this, this is illegal, it's immoral, etc., etc. But that's what they are doing on a massive scale. Do you think people would listen to them? They must set the example. And that's what I was seeking to do through the judgment in the nuclear weapons case, to try to stir world opinion to the point where the nuclear powers themselves would realize their obligation to not only step down their arsenals, but wipe out their arsenals. And that's what they said they would do. They are not doing it. On the contrary, expenditure on nuclear tests is increasing, and we are getting closer and closer to a world which has even more dangerous nuclear weapons. I remember, and it was so sad to think of it, there was a lady who came from the Marshall Islands who gave evidence before us when we were hearing this case. And she said, "Your gentleman, I've come all the way from the Marshall Islands to give you first-hand evidence about the damage done by nuclear testing in our countries. Without our permission, great powers come and test nuclear weapons. And then later we have babies born with two heads, babies deformed, so deformed that the parents bury them away before the neighbors know that a deformed baby has been born. Babies with translucent skins, you see the heart pulsating through underneath, and they are not babies, they are like turtles. That sort of thing. And that is what these powers are imposing on us without our consent. And please take steps to try to remove this danger from the face of the earth." What are we doing? We are not removing the danger, we are increasing the danger. And one of the problems is this, that all traditional societies thought of the long-term future. We, in our modern civilization, we think greatly of ourselves, of course. We are not thinking of the long-term future. We are governed not by the interests of future generations. We are governed by the next balance sheet, which is only 1 year away. We have got to show profits. Or we are governed by the next ballot box, which is 2 or 3 years away, and we have got to show some results. Who is worried about what's going to happen 7 generations from now? Whereas they say the ancient Red Indians, they used to say that no proper decision could be taken concerning the tribe or the future of the village unless you thought of 7 generations to come. That's what they said. African tribal wisdom, as Archbishop Tutu has often reminded us, said, the human community is threefold: those who went before us, those who are alive here and now, and those who are yet to come. If you think only in terms of those who are alive here and now, it is a lopsided decision. Aboriginal wisdom, all that traditional, beautiful Aboriginal art, linked us to Mother Nature by a sort of umbilical cord. If Mother Nature prospers, we prosper. If Mother Nature withers and dies, we wither and die. All that wisdom is there in all the traditions of the world. Why are we neglecting this? And why are we international lawyers not working even harder to educate the lawyers of the future about this enormous responsibility that we have towards future generations? It so happens also that, you know, I told you about my participating in this American bicentennial. It so happened that I was in New York on 9/11. That was another great experience I had. I was due to give a lecture at New York University that day. So I arrived the previous day. I was comfortably accommodated. I had a good breakfast that morning. And I was getting ready to make for a staff seminar at 12:30 and a lecture to the students at 4:30. About 10:30 or 11, the janitor knocked on my door and said, "Sir, a terrible thing has happened. Please come to the window, I'll show you." And he took me to the window and I saw the blazing towers. It was a sight, you know, you could never forget. And in that situation, I saw students huddled together, not knowing what to do. They did not know what had happened to their children, to their families, how to get re-established communication. They were trapped within the building. And so I went to the dean and said, "Well, let's cancel the staff seminar." He said, "Yes, that might be a reasonable thing, but let's just assemble in the staff room and see who turns up." So at 12:30, we went into the staff room. And what do you think? The whole staff turned up. Not because they wanted to hear me, but because they couldn't get out of the building. And there they were. And I had the opportunity of speaking to them and giving them these perspectives of how the Western world has ignored the wisdom, traditional wisdom, of all the other wonderful systems of the world. You know, now I told you a lot about Hindu wisdom, Buddhist wisdom, Islamic wisdom. All that was totally unknown to the rest of the world. And this is one thing that I mentioned in my speech at the bicentennial also. People like Lord Macaulay, you know, we all have the greatest respect for Lord Macaulay as one of the most erudite Englishmen of his time. But he was also a member of the Viceroy's Council of India. And you know that in one of his minutes on education, he wrote this sentence: "All the native literature of India and Arabia put together is not equal to one shelf of a good English library." Now, what stark ignorance that is. And that was on the part of one of the most wonderful scholars that England had in the 19th century. But on the other hand, there were some wonderful scholars. For example, the Marquis of Zetland, who was a Viceroy of India, wrote this letter to the Home Office, in which he said, "All our wonderful parliamentary system of three readings of a bill and a whip and a speaker and so on were all anticipated by the Buddhists in their councils, in the Buddhist councils of 2,000 years ago." That's there in the memorandum of Zetland. And he gives in detail how the matter was proposed, how it was put to the vote. If it was an important matter, then the votes were counted. And if it was an important matter, it went through three readings, all of which is an anticipation of parliamentary procedure, which the British think they invented in recent times. It was there 2,000 years ago. So all this traditional wisdom was ignored by Western countries, and they shaped international law to suit their own ends. And it became Eurocentric, dominated by economic values, dominated by political values. And there was imperialism and colonialism, which violated every principle that Christ taught. Do not take other people's property, do not enslave them, treat them with respect, etc., etc. Every one of those was violated by colonialism under legal systems that were supposedly Christian. So there has been a terrible separation from religion, between religion and law. The situation is very acute. It has grown so acute that we are in danger of an elimination of all civilization. If we do not rise to the challenge, we are failing in our trust. It is a tremendous duty lying on each and every one of us, not only to do what we can ourselves, but also to impregnate in the minds of the younger generation the obligation they have, both towards themselves and their future generations. We have already polluted it for 25,000 years. Irreparable damage has been done. But let us try to stop this damage before it really destroys the human race. Now, that is our obligation. That is the obligation we have had for the last 70 years. That is the obligation we have neglected. That is the challenge to which we must now rise if we are to save humanity. Thank you.